So I'm going to talk about the research project, which is called the State of Noland, and which deals with one of the subjects of the nation state, its nature, its past, its present, and most importantly, its possible futures. You might notice that it's written in a bit in a weird way. There are a lot of aesthetic things that are in here, but there are a lot of some things that are dealing directly with the political theory and political science. So first of all, I would like to quote Justin Trudeau, the Prime Minister of Canada, the country that in contemporary political context normally is quoted as something that is rather on the good side of the thing. So just a year ago at the celebrations in France of anniversary of the Battle of the Rimy Bridge, he told it was through their sacrifice about, he was talking about the Canadian soldiers who were fighting, about I think 6,000 Canadian soldiers who were fighting on the side of Allies. Of the Entente in the First World War. He said, it was through their sacrifice that Canada became an independent signatory of Treaty of Versailles. And in that sense, and in that way, Canada was born here. And before I go on, I would like to a little bit deconstruct that that sort of pompous sentence, because it deals exactly with those three words that are following the title of the talk. So first of all, it talks about the Canada as independent signatory of the Treaty of Versailles. So it talks about the recognition of sovereignty of Canada. It talks also about Canada as independently formed nation to that point. So it talks about, it basically deals with the issue of nationality already being recognized as something separate from the metropolia. It talks about the recognition of something that is a Treaty of Versailles or something that was signed by the group of the empires and the group of the states that basically structure itself around the homogenization of the their borders and homogenization of the state as such. So it has those three components within it that are actually defining, from our perspective, from the perspective of this research, the three fundamental, let's say, saints of the nation state of today. The saint called empire, the saint called nation, and the saint called sovereignty. And a bit further, I will elaborate on each of them individually. So that's a cover of the book that was published in 1651. That book is called The Leviathan, and it was written by Thomas Hobbes. And in that book, Thomas Hobbes introduced the idea of a nation state, basically the idea of a sovereign. And that word was specifically referred to in that book as an innovation of Thomas Hobbes, where he talked about that metaphor of a state as a this sort of a meta-human that is combined out of the components of the citizens that combine that total body. And they are all united by specific characteristics that are highlighting their unity and highlighting the idea of having a specific goal that is somehow embedded in a vision of the future desirable by someone's design, but agreed by all of those components and elements of that body. But also another date that is quite interesting in that context, just 3 years before that, in 1648, the very important treaty also was signed, the Treaty of Westphalia. 1648 ended up one of the actually bloodiest wars in the European history by recognizing actually the national borders as such the very first time. Because actually, if you look into the medieval history of Europe, up to that moment, and specifically up to the moment of 18th century, then in 19th century, actually 19th century, even it was also quite omnipresent in places like France, Germany. There was not Germany at that point as well, and the Holy Roman Empire. Actually, if you would ask majority of the people who were inhabiting those territories, they really did not know where they live, actually. They knew the name of the sovereign. They knew the name of the king on whose behalf they are taxed. But they didn't really know what's become, it was not really important to know what country you are, in a way, assigned to. Plus, the language situation was much more complicated to that point. And therefore, the elements that combined the contemporary nation states actually started to form gradually. And the very fundamental center of those components that then structured around itself understanding of what nation state has become at the moment is that figure of the father, of sovereign. And although, again, we can refer to Hobbes in that sense, and I refer to Hobbes as the maybe first theoretician who highlighted the presence of that sovereign. But actually, the idea of that sort of unified body or unified father somehow, which also has very paternalistic and very patriarchal way of view, out of which you can unweave misogyny and many other things, coming from the theology as well and coming from religion. And if you go into even polytheisms, into ideas of what the father god, even equal somehow in the structure of the of another pantheon of gods, for example, there was this specific idea of the father. So that was sort of an idea that was cooking for quite a while. When we talk about also nation states, when we talk about the contemporary condition of nation states, it's very important to, I think, remember a theorist that's quite often discarded, but still referred to in political science, but rather sort of in a very an environment where you sort of speak about it in half voice, whose name is Carl Schmitt, or he was also known as a lawyer of the Nazi party. But a part of the that sort of label that he got, he wrote a very important book that was called Political Theology, where he was the very first political theorist connecting directly religion and politics, actually. And in that book, he very interestingly drew the line of distinction between two terms, terms of politics and terms political. And although the quote is from the book on him, but basically the quote is paraphrasing something that he wrote, is that the political is to be understood as the force that exists within the individual and is necessarily directed towards other people in the form of desire for power. So basically, Schmitt was the first who highlighted that political basically structured around specific sort of a force or energy or desire to dominate. It doesn't have to do with relations in between of people. It doesn't have to do with desire to construct some sort of a future or something like that. It has the specific function of being able, for those who are retaining that political power, impose their will, whatever it is, basically. And in most of the cases, according to Schmitt, that will actually might even not be directed on a specific form of understanding of the society. It's just a value per se. It's a thing in itself. And the politics, in that sense, as opposed to the concept of the political, is exactly human relations, something that we do on everyday business, something that we are constructing with friends, family, co-workers, and so on and so on. So this distinction is very important for understanding the context of the context and the concept of contemporary nation state, because they are uniquely designed around that ontological value of political and power, as well as the election mechanism and so on. Let's look into that body. I'll call this chapter of a talk anatomy of that modern Leviathan, because we still live in these modern Leviathans. We still approach ourselves in the first question we're asking, where are you from, where you grew up, where we were born, and so on. And it's still quite boring, to be honest, conversations. I don't know how for you, but for me, it's incredibly boring normally. This conversation, that's how starts sort of from that perspective, because they immediately lead you to labeling you and to attaching you to one of these particular meta bodies, putting you inside of this body somehow, consciously or unconsciously, in a way. But it's something that gives you the identity of this particular sort of a meta-individual that is actually fictional. To quote again Carl Schmitt, is the definition of that sovereign, the definition of that particular body. What makes this sovereign so different, for example, from idea of, for example, of an empire of the ancient, for example, history, or the idea of the Greek polis, or the idea of you know, numerous political systems that waned in history just because people did not write, and we don't have archives, or someone burned them, or and so on and so on. The sovereign, as we know the sovereign now, actually is defined by the decision on the state of exception. It's not the rule that matters, actually. What matters is exception from that rule. The definition of the norm in itself and the flexibility of the role in itself is defined by the actor that is able to twist it at the particular moment of necessity. And basically, these rules are existing on in different patchworks of that sort of body. And if you crossed the work, for example, of Antonin Artaud, very interesting theorist of theater, who talked about the political anatomy, actually, and looking at the political anatomy of the human body, I would propose to look at the political anatomy of the nation state, or this sovereign, this particular sovereign. And again, theory of the nation state is something of a very peculiar case in political science. And actually, political science is very much interestingly avoiding the subject of analyzing the future of the nation state without speaking of the nation state as a sort of a universal and inevitable tabula rasa of the political context, political structure. It's something that meant to be the ultimate point of departure, and more or less the analysis, for example, of the political system or political experiments, for example, of the much previous timing in the history of humanity are sort of analyzed through the perspective of the nation state, which is really interesting because these are the components that are listed in the parts of this Leviathan are what is regularly referred to the concept of the nation state. So it's normally have some symbolic power, some specific symbols, so flags, coats of arms and national anthems, for example, that actually were introduced just in the 19th century as well, and were all also deriving from British national anthem, which is also quite funny. Speaking about, you know, the imperial production, then it has the some institutions that confirming the legality of the issues. It has the national culture, it has norms, both political, social, and cultural. It has the image of the external enemy. It has the image of monopoly on the external violence and the state of exception that might be introduced. Therefore, I'm always a little bit staying silent in conversations when someone speaks about, for example, the nation state persecuting someone on its territory, because it's sort of like a natural thing that nation state would do, and it actually has a complete freedom to do that. So basically, if you are surveilled and if someone wants to destroy you within your own borders, whether you live in Denmark or you live in, Russia in that sense, or United States, you're actually unsafe because there is anyway ways how to you can sleep in between of these lines that define the parts of this Leviathan. Because actually the monopoly of an internal violence is a sacred, basically, right of the nation state. It's something that nation state is sacredly defining itself in a sense of the being an institution of its own sort of structure. Then it's the unified system of education, unified language, it's also the presence of the army, and so on. And there are basically those components in plus minus two basically are referred to the majority of the political scientists as something that defines the complete nation state. But the funny thing that actually there is no examples of the complete fitting all these requirements nation state on the planet. Basically, it's a sort of a form or shape that represent a specific ideal that is more of a pretense of existence of something rather than a material entity that somehow actually we embody. So it's really, again, referring back to Carl Schmitt and political theology, it's actually a religious concept to some sense. We believe in nation state. We believe in specific norms and the institutions. And our belief embodies them in that form. Moreover, having that particular frame locks our imaginary to the of the alternative in reproduction, for example, of the politics of relations in between of each other on the basis of that structure of the political, the structure of power that actually sort of ties in it together. Because if you would imagine basically these parts somehow glued in each other, exactly the desire for political power is something that is gluing this whole body into the sovereign then we associate with culturally, politically, in a flag term, responding to the question and so on. But then basically, if you would imagine of removing that glue to some extent and thinking about the those components that are mentioned in here, and something more in a perspective of the function that they provide you, or more something that is more they define when you are abstracting from the idea of that sovereign that is somehow defining or giving you this sort of identity and structure. And this list is incredibly arbitrary. I would say that there are a lot of interesting ideas that are going already around, and they're very destructured or restructured somehow. that are allowing us to think or liberate the imaginary that, again, locked down to that tabula rasa of the nation state. And again, as soon as we talk about, for example, the global governance and so on, we are inevitably arriving to some specific hierarchical structure where there will be, I don't know, the president of the world or president of European Commission or head of European Union, whatever in that sense. It's anyway locking down to the idea of creating some sort of a meta state. But it's again the same form of the state that we're arriving to. But what's sort of the purpose of the research that we are engaging with is to think about, is to remove that sort of platform of tabula rasa and think about the political organization without the power being contained in it. And I speak about this power point a bit later as well. But basically, for example, if you talk about education, you have possibility of looking into the idea of multiple epistemologies and knowledges, and you already have the specific institutions that are quite challenging the idea of singular science and idea of singular science. In a sense of the idea of hierarchy, you have a lot of work done on the imagining rhizomatic network structures that are actually do not have center. In the idea of providing legality or trust somehow, actually a very important component of the nation state, you have technologies, and again, it's maybe a subject for 2 hours of other talk. You have technologies like blockchain that are a bit of a dark opportunity in that sense, existing in this rather layered down here platform of potencies, but something that actually could provide something interesting in that line, and so on and so on. Then you could also talk about principles instead of norms. You can talk about the enemy as actually political. You can talk about power as enemy in that sense. You could not talk about, for example, instead of celebrating the election of some particular politician, it's heading this growl of power for 4 years. We maybe should mourn it, actually, because someone else, again, they got the specific way of reproduction, the power that's actually the ontological value in itself. Another illustration from the gravure age that I wanted to put there is another interesting book that I wanted to refer to, actually, again, to Thomas Hobbes. And it's another Thomas, which is funny, I think. That might be some sort of also a very semantic and meaningful coincidence. It's Thomas More. Thomas More's illustration of utopia. And utopia as such is also, as well as a nation state, appeared on the pages of the historical writers and also mythological writers much before something like utopia was formulated. For example, Herodotus was writing about Atlantis as a sort of a very fantastic place where everything is fine and citing that there is no slavery and so on and some other things that really annoyed him very much in the context of the ancient Greek world. But utopia actually in most of the cases is approached as a rather a sort of a fantastical way of escaping into the fantasy from that terrible world that we're living in and where nothing is changeable. But in the context of the political, I think it's also a very interesting point to look at the utopia not as a way to imagine the unrealizable communities and unrealizable societies, but rather to look at utopia as a critical strategy, basically, as utopia as a mechanism to exactly pinpoint these areas of the political that are actually gluing this whole system, that are invisible, and that are actually defining the unity of it in a sense that providing that sense of somehow solidity to the whole system, sense of presence of something that is actually ephemeral in the first place. This funny illustration I included exactly to illustrate that actually the political structure, as we talk about it, is still coming from that 17th century. And technologically, the advances that are providing very interesting ideas for somehow avoiding that glue in between of the stitching the nation state are actually also not really were born today only. The ideas of the and radical utopias, basically, of 20th century and both in art and in politics and so on, were already rather not proposing the alternative, actually. And that's exactly one of the points of the research, not look at them at the alternatives to the society as a whole and not take it as a sort of another nation state or another state, basically, as a production of the political design, but as a criticism that allowed to convert that particular structure of today into something else. And here I'm sort of already coming to the State of Noland in itself and this experiment that we're staging with it. So State of Noland was born as an attempt to create the infrastructure, to create a sort of a first very raw draft of something that then can become a foundation for gradual accumulation of collaborations with people coming from different disciplines, artists, political scientists, political institutions, political parties, and so on, that actually would look at the nation state from that particular perspective, would look at political as a disease, but not as a sort of an inherent value within the nation state, not something that actually structures it around, but something actually that is inevitably wrong about constructing the political communities around. And we identified those eight elements that we would like to focus on, and they are titled here in Latin, but basically they include institutions, they include the enemy, they include the culture, symbols, education, they include order or the internal violence, the legality and or the court system. Basically that's point of an image there, and those words that I highlighted there, the representation of political homogenization and inheritance, is something that actually those three words are representing. Because in if you look at the nation as such, basically, you inherit your nationality. You inherit it by the right of being born in there. You can be born again. I'm, for example, national of both Belgium and Russia. But I sort of was born again in Belgium too. It's a really weird feeling. For whoever who got the second passport, I wonder how you sort of feel this sort of moment when you realize that you're suddenly getting born again in this way. But it's sort of something that you inherit through assignment in a way. And then that actually I would connect to the idea of inheritance in economy as well, to inheritance of capital as well. Further, something that is taken naturally, basically, something that's approached naturally, and I would say that inheritance in that sense is one of the fundamental problems that are supporting basically the structure of the nation state. And as soon as we're not talking about this issue, basically a conversation about the post-nation state is a bit incomplete. The same goes for homogenization, which is actually stands for empire, of course, because empire are meant to unify cultures, to unify languages, unify educations, unify systems, taxations, and so on and so on. This is still all that we're not speaking about. We speak about the collapse of the empires and so on, but it's actually not really correct, I think. I think it's much more correct to speak about the post-imperial stage as the conversion of the empires into something else, into the component of the nation state, becoming an inherent brick into the whole system. And then the sovereignty actually stands for exactly power, for political, for that inherent ontological narrative. And for example, working as a political consultant before sort of moving in the crazy area where the political paradigms are still not sort of ready to talk on the matter of seriousness somehow. The most interesting politicians that you would ever work with actually are not the ones that clearly understand what they want. The most interesting politicians are the ones actually that are inherently obsessed with idea of getting something that they could not even formulate in any way. And that's what I call this sort of energy of political in a way. It's somehow relating to art very, very, very acutely. And that also, I think, what made me convert into the art and politics and somehow deal with this subject. And you're probably all aware of the concept of aura in art and so on. Politics has its own aura, which sometimes referred in theory as plasma, as something else. But it's this inherent ontology of desire to dominate in a way. And that's represented. And the funny thing, I think, the finally tragic thing, I think, that over this 150 years since the formation of the first empires, that political skeleton basically became the actual sort of main system of constructing the whole society around itself. Something actually that is not productive in any way, not structured in any sense, becomes this sort of thing that structures the political organism around. Actually, a bit continuing the line of Ella with the performing states, actually part of the project as well deals with exactly trying to see what could be already used in order to undermine those sort of borders within the nation states and fill these borders with something else, actually, because again, I think the biggest problem also about talking when there is a conversation coming out about the utopia is that utopias are always taken as a sort of a whole systemic project that is meant to arrive written on a beautiful paper somehow and being approved and immediately replace the nation state. But it's a process, actually. That's the critical process of engaging with the nation state need to start from the point of actually highlighting the exactly those holes in between of the nation-state structure and replacing them with something else. For example, there is this very interesting case of Principality of Sealand that actually is the nation-state existing in a limbo that was born out of partly an accident, basically, of the British soldier that's conquered in 1987 the maritime platform outside of the British territorial borders, so basically claiming the right of finding somehow a new land, although it was a military platform that was disused during the Second World War. And he proclaimed in there the Principality of Sealand. But the exactly what I wanted to bring up that project exactly to say what we want do not want to create with that project. We do not want to create another idea of the nation state or reclaim somehow critically from the nation state its faultiness, because I think it's pretty obvious in that way. The most important point of the State of Nolent as the project, and that's sort of the map as we see it in that structure, is to gradually replace the ideas that are embodying these institutions of the nation states with something that actually provides the, not the alternative in a way, but provides the replacement to that essential need to have the sovereign already as the fundamental basis of constructing reality around the political reality, the identification with anything and so on. Coming to the point of the of this particular project, the State of Nolent, we engage there with an idea of trying to morph the existing infrastructural, somehow available instruments with the conceptual innovations or something that exists outside of this logic of the nation state that was incorporated within the nation state in the first place. So first of all, State of Nolent is not the state per se. It's not really that's very important point in this research, that it's not an attempt to recreate something that it means to imitate somehow or restructure the nation state in another functional form, or create out of it, I don't know, a supranational internet, whatever. It's rather something that is meant to represent the idea of organizing politics without the political. And that's what we call the state after state, the politics that has political contained within it. Because again, removing political as such is a very, very complicated issue, I would say, because I do not want to go into the psychology, and it's a very dangerous also area in political science as well. But the state after state, it's state after state as a rather of a constellation of the functions that is not meant to immediately replace anything, or it's not meant to make you throw away your passports. I actually love getting passports. I would get like three more if possible. It's actually purely an experimental way of looking at how you can distance yourself from particular point where it is possible at that particular moment. And for example, with this particular quadrant in here, I think we already can do quite a lot in that sense. With producing, for example, things like that are already displacing somehow the identity as such and the representation at the level where the nation state actually established its monopoly just quite recently, just in the 19th century, sort of establishing this idea of the unity of the power. You actually can say already whatever you want in a way. No one would basically be able somehow in any way on your words check you up somehow, I don't know, or verify that. So the symbols is a very religious thing in that sense, and something that's already very much replaceable. Then we go to the point of the state of Nolent being also a state of mind, and that's why it's Nolent as well. Because the geopolitics as such, and that's I think what was very, I think, beautiful in Ella's presentation, the idea of the terrestrialization of the planet, in a way, in order to also expand the borders, deals exactly with the point that the land in itself, and country actually, comes from the word country comes from contraire, comes from something of the opposite, something that actually is meant to have a border per se, something that is meant to have an observable, basically, image of the enemy or something that you need to protect yourself against. And that's why I think that's very important to speak about nation state also as a state of mind, not only as a state not as a political state, basically, or some sort of a set of institutions that is meant to structure itself around. So the state also moving into that direction and speaking about the nation state as rather a condition, basically, that we are all are in somehow, as we are basically theologically would be in a condition of all being very devoted Catholics and going to the church and participating in masses and so on. We are sort of in the same way religiously participate and sometimes meaningless almost political rituals as well, as for example in some cases in most of the what is called democracies now, elections in a way, and so on and so on. This point of the having the idea of that state of mind as well being displaced and being also contested with another ideas that are referred to utopian not as a sort of a way of thinking about the metaphorical escape concept in a Netflix series, but rather something that is actually pinpointing the specific divisions within the nation state structure and actually even penetrating them. Like for example, with these cards, I do this performance as much as I can. Actually, whenever I'm asked ID, I'm trying to first of all show this one, and actually, you know, I was buying tickets with it. I was passing by a lot of things. I'm passing up in the bars and so on and so on. I had a couple of times quite a funny situations when I was actually asked sort of, I cannot find it in the database. How can I write it? And I asked them to add it in the database, asking them like, so, well, why don't you have it? It's really strange. Why don't you have it? Maybe the database is old or something like that. That's what I called about the penetration in a way, sort of already coming into the structure of the what is called and what is defining this sort of unique monopoly of the nation state on claiming the identity and sovereignty. And sort of this list is also as arbitrary as the list of those components that were drawn down on the reimagined Leviathan without the borders. And I really love that phrase that was coined in one interview I did with Boaventura de Sousa Santos, who is one of the experts on the nation state building in the contemporary Europe and participated a lot actually in the restructuring European Union and is quite now disappointed with what it's becoming at the moment. In order to reimagine the nation state, actually, we don't need to think of alternative. We need to think about alternative. We need to alternatively think about alternatives in the first place. And that's what I mean by state of mind in that sense. And it's much more difficult task than it might seem, actually. It might be hurt in a way, because it's some things that are already existing almost on the level of unconscious. Basically, coming to these terms there of cosmopolitia, which I will go very very quickly around because it's still sort of in a rough process of production. What we are experimenting with the state of Noland, we are on the basis of the blockchain, and we're actually going to be presenting this project in Moscow in a couple of weeks. On the basis of the blockchain, in the contemporary moment, it's a contemporary blockchain that we're using is Ethereum. Don't ask me why, because there is no basically reason. It's just maybe just because it's the most trustable now at the moment, and the one that is actually not connected directly to profit production and has sort of NGO value to it. We will distribute the private and public keys. Basically, of course, private key you receive yourself. I don't know if you know how the blockchain basically works, but you get private and public key. The public key is something that identifies you within the blockchain. The private key is something that you should never share with anyone because that's exactly your identity. So we're going to introduce the online portal, basically, through which we will give you all the instructions of how you can claim your private key and your public key. Then we will ask you to send us your public key with whatever information you want to include in the system of the state of Noland, whatever you want to be called, whatever you are, either you're one person or you're a group of people, you want to create a group identity. That's also a very important point, not limiting identity to a particular biopolitical body of a particular person. If you have a group of people who want to claim identity, it's great, no problem. And that's what is called here the queer identities, but that's the word queer here is another point of, you know, half an hour conversation. The algorithmic trust network is exactly the point of the blockchain in here, and engagement with normalized institution is what I referred to in, for example, performing the alternative citizenships like I do with the state of Noland card, and something that I hope people would do with the state of Noland card as well at some point. But engagement with normalized institution also meant to talk about it in a sort of a normalized environment. For example, in the context of discussing with political parties, potential. I, for example, joined two for that particular reason. I joined the ALDE and I joined Mera 25, just for the sake, again, of sort of pushing this agenda in confusing things more and sort of speaking about the agendas not within this sort of contained environment of experimentations and utopia, but actually indeed for filling out these particular things. The most important point of that project as well, that it's meant to be open source. It's not controlled by the Near Institute in any way. We are using specifically blockchain for that reason and creating the algorithm in order to make it open and in order not to make the hierarchy there present, basically. So there is no hierarchy and there is no political, if you would ask me, there is no political mechanism in there. There is no redistribution of power. Because the very first task we put in front of ourselves for that structure is to create the trust, actually, to create a community, basically, that identifies with something, and that first of all deals with symbolum, sort of, with this point of reference to something that actually is not connected to any particular territory and not connected to any particular culture. That's what referred into that big Leviathan picture to pastiche, sort of. It's was what we are, I think, anyway, in that point. And on that, I think I'll already stop. Thank you so much.